expect right
now. That's
curiosity, yeah. I have a pit bull cat. All right, well, guys, we want to welcome you again back to this session. And this will be a session that we're going to have first, and then we'll have questions and answers after that. So we don't want to wait any longer. Please.
I know. Everybody's like, all right, we'll get you this one. You know, I have this nasty habit. I do this, make this mistake all the time. When Jeff and I do marriage conferences and seminars, and often in the morning, I'll be the one going through the agenda. And I'll say, okay, so here's our agenda for the day. And you know, this happened a couple weeks ago. I said, okay, so first session, we're gonna have to move around a little bit. So first session will be in here, you know, in sanctuary, we're gonna talk about men. Second session will also be in here in the sanctuary, talking about women, and then we'll break for lunch, and then after lunch we'll do sex in the fellowship hall. And you can see everybody sit up. So let's talk about the subject.
We gotta build that fellowship hall.
Yeah. And so let's tackle this subject for a minute. And I'm gonna tackle it from both the marriage standpoint and from the single standpoint. Because I know we have people in here, both. I know we have parents of teenagers, etc. So I want to cover both sides of this because it's actually quite interesting what we found out in the research. First thing you need to know, ladies, just so you know, when we turned in for men only, you know, the project that Jeff and I did about women, you know, knowing that this is a subject that men are quite interested in, especially. I mean, it's important to us as women too, but you know, very motivated men. Chapter 6 in this book is the sex chapter. And when we turned it into our editor, the first words in chapter 6 were, "Welcome to the book." Because we know these are the first words you were reading. Because all the men who read the book are like, yeah, that's where they go first. And you know the book for teenage boys. The first words of the sex chapter are, "Welcome to the book, you're busted." Okay, so let's talk about this. I'm going to talk to the women first and to the men second. So talk to the women about the men first. So, okay, ladies, here's the deal. We have this enormous misunderstanding about this subject. We think of physical intimacy in marriage as being primarily a physical need for him. That's kind of the category we put it in. You know, we say it's a physical need, it's a physical urge. And you know, probably like at least some of the people in here, I have two small children, and when you have been pulled on by little hands all day, sleep seems like a physical need too. Can I get an amen or something? And here's the issue. When I was going around and I was interviewing men about this, and I was saying, okay, what is the importance of this in your life? What is the importance of this? What I kept hearing from the men had nothing to do with the physical. It had nothing to do with it. What I kept hearing from the men was this huge emotional need that the men couldn't get met any other way. And so, ladies, here's what the need is. It's the need that every man has to feel that his wife desires him and that she wants him. And if a man feels that his wife desires him, it gives that man a sense of confidence, really, and a sense of well-being in all of the other areas of his life. And conversely, if he feels like he's not being desired, if he feels like it's a little too easy for her to say, you know what, honey, I'm just really tired, it gives him this dragging sense, like, I must be so undesirable I can't even compete with a pillow. Right? This sort of dragging sense almost of depression, really, and a lack of well-being in every other area of his life. So, you know, what you're hearing right there, that is not primarily a physical need at all, is it? There really is this emotional need. And as I said, it's really one that he can't get met any other way. So, now here's the problem. We as women, we have heard this before, and we know that it's important to men. And like I said, it is important to us too. But as you will see on the flip side, we are wired very differently. And so we as women, knowing that this is important to our husbands, sometimes women might take the approach of, okay, I'll do my duty. Clearly nobody in here, apparently, would ever respond that way, but hypothetically. And I was telling one of the men I was interviewing this, okay, I'll do my duty, you know, thing that sometimes women feel. And he said, do you mind if I'm real direct about what he said? Is that okay? Okay. He said, I'm sorry. A man would rather go out and clip hedges in the freezing rain and make love to a wife who seemed to be responding out of duty. And the first time I heard that, it was pretty early on in the research, and I went to my husband, I said, I don't get it. He'd still be getting sex. What's the problem? And Jeff looked at me, he said, no, you're not getting it. If she is only responding because she has to, he is being rejected by his wife. And it's the deepest form of rejection for a man because it is so core to how they feel about themselves in every other area of their life. So this was a huge paradigm shift for me. And I realized, you know, ladies, we have to take a phrase out of our vocabulary. We have to stop saying, you know, he wants more sex, you know, because that's really not the issue. It's he wants to feel desired by me.
And this has. Amen.
Yeah, this is what
that's
it. That's it. That's it. That's it.
That's it. That's it.
You'll hear most women, not all, you know, this is definitely an area where some couples are switched, absolutely, but in the majority of cases, we just don't realize what an impact it has in the other areas of life. And so I love this one comment, that this one guy on the survey, I love how he put this. He said, I don't think my wife realizes that what happens the night before in the bedroom absolutely impacts how I feel about myself the next day at the office. It's this one-for-one relationship. What happens the night before in the bedroom absolutely impacts how I feel about myself the next day at the office. I thought that was a perfect encapsulation of this. And, you know, it made sense of something that happened a few years ago. I was speaking at a church, and several of the people, like you guys, some of you had read the book before I came, right? And so, same thing at this one church that I was at, and this woman came up to me at the book table during a break, and she looked like she was relatively young, you know, late 20s, and she was pushing a baby stroller with a little baby in it, and she said, you know, I have to tell you, you know, I read your book one Saturday, and you know, we had had this new baby, and there wasn't a whole lot of action going on at our house, and she said, my husband is the worship pastor here at the church, And she said, but I read your book, it was a Saturday, and so I thought, okay, you know, this is really vital for us to get this relationship back, you know, back into gear. And so she said, we had a really good night that night. And she said, the next morning, Sunday morning, people were coming up to my husband all morning going, that was the best worship ever. Pastor Mark is unbelievable. She said her husband was standing up on the stage with his guitar, listening to them going, thank you. Fine. And for us to realize that we just put put it in the wrong category. We think of it as a physical need, and it's not. I mean, it is, but it's not. You know, it's not a demand. It's not a selfish physical demand. It's this emotional need that really builds a man up to be the man that he wants to be for you. It is powerful when we recognize that. So let's flip the tables for a minute, and then I also want to share the singles application of it, but let's flip the tables. So for the guys to know about the women, see, because for you, it's about feeling desired. If it's not happening, you think there's only one reason why, and it's that you're just not desirable enough to her. And so we, on our survey, we gave the women this whole big list of options, and we basically said, okay, you know, if you tend to want this less than your husband, which not everybody did, like I said, quite a few couples were flipped, but for those who said they tended to wanted that less, what are the reasons why? What are all the reasons why? We have a big list of all these different things they can choose from. You know what percentage of the women said it was because he's not desirable? 4%. 4% said that. 96% said it was something else. And the something else broke down into two categories. One much more important than the other, one much more numerically important than the other. The second reason that was something you've probably heard before, which is that women do have to feel close outside the bedroom in order to want to feel close inside the bedroom. That's a big deal for men to understand. But you've probably heard that before. And that's certainly played out in the survey, but that was the number two reason. The number one reason is something that a lot of us don't know. I certainly didn't know this. And it's a physiological difference between men and women. It turns out that there are two different types of desire. There's something called assertive desire. And someone with assertive desire has a desire to pursue sex and to initiate it and to think about it all the time and be ready at a moment's notice. Guess who tends to have assertive desire? Okay? It tends to be tied, not always, but it tends to be tied to testosterone and other typically male hormones. Okay, but there's a totally different type of desire, and that's called receptive desire. And someone with receptive desire is just as willing, just as interested, enjoys it just as much when it's happening, but doesn't have the same desire to pursue it or initiate it, doesn't think about it all the time, and isn't ready in a moment's notice. Guess who tends to have receptive desire? It tends to be tied to estrogen and other typically female hormones. And here's the thing, guys, for you to be aware, is that basically, because someone with receptive desire tends to be the wife, not always, but tends to be. Someone with receptive desire just has to be approached differently. So what this means is that she has got to know what's on your menu for the evening before you get to the bedroom. She needs what we call anticipation time, to sort of for her body to warm up, for her brain to warm up all that estrogen in her body and be thinking about this, which she would not be thinking about otherwise. And now men, just so you know, ladies, men hear me say this and men think, you mean I need to warn her? Okay, this is very deflating. To the male ego. And no, guys, see, this is the thing. This is not for you thinking of it ahead of time. You think of it as, I need to warn her. No, she needs anticipation time. And I'll tell you why. And I'll give you an example. So let's just say you're hoping to get lucky that night. Okay? So you, before work, you say, you know, let me unload the dishwasher for you. Or, you know, maybe she's a stay-at-home mom. And you say, you know, how about I go to work a little bit late today so you can run out and do something that you've been wanting to do for a while. And you're doing all these sweet things. And, you know, maybe you come home from work and you're still hoping to get lucky. And so you take the kids, you take the kids off and you go to the playground and you let her have a chance for a long call with a girlfriend, or, you know, to go out to dinner with or a movie with a friend. And maybe you're still hoping to get lucky, so you you do some chores around the house, or you know, you scrub the toilets or whatever it is. Will any of those things make her think about sex? It's not gonna occur to her that all of these sweet things that you're doing are related to that. And you can be trying all that, you can be arranging the sweetest, most romantic date, and you've got a very specific endpoint in mind for that date. But unless you signal that in some way, it's just, if she's got receptive desire, it is just not going to be popping up in her mind. And so she's not going to be anticipating for it. And then for her, it'll come out of the blue. And you know, as one woman, I love this comment from this one woman who would put this comment in for men only at the very, 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 very last minute. I mean, literally, this was a classic case of stop the presses. They had typeset the book, it was ready to go, and this comment came in on her website. And I said, this is a perfect encapsulation. She says, I don't think my husband realizes that, you know, there is this, for women, you know, when we've been busy all day, we've been taking care of the kids or working or doing these things, it's almost like we're just looking forward like a cruise ship headed to port. And you know, we're like, port is that oasis of peace and quiet when the kids are finally down and the house is clean and the house is quiet and we're finally, you know, in bed with our head on the pillow, we're just inside of that port. And my husband rolls over and says, what you doing over there? And she said, it's not that I don't want to be with him, but my mind is set like a cruise ship headed for port. I can't turn on a dime in a speedboat like he can. And that's the thing, guys, is realize that all these sweet things that you might be doing, and you really want to do them for her, but you're also hoping for this endpoint in mind. She's not going to know that because she's just not thinking about it. So, what do you do? This is definitely where the guy who like, okay, enough with the information. Just tell me what to do about it. Basically, she needs to have anticipation time, like I said. And that can take so many forms, but it is basically this kind of flirting with her so that she's aware of what you've got on your mind for the evening or whenever. And, you know, here's an example, okay? My husband, this is something he said not that long ago, where we were over breakfast, and I can't remember what it was that we were talking about, but he had done something real sweet. And I said, because I'm trying to focus on the what, you know, every man, they want women to notice, they want people to notice what they do, remember this? So I'm trying to practice this, and I'm saying, and I said to him, you know, thank you for doing that, honey. I really, really appreciate it. That was so sweet of you. And he said, just remember that later tonight. And I thought, I said, okay, and can I steal that? Can I mention that? Because that's a perfect example. It wasn't this like big romantic thing. It was just this little comment that woke up my brain because I wouldn't be thinking about it otherwise. So just realize, guys, your wife needs to be approached differently. If you're the one with the assertive desire and she's the one with receptive desire, this approach is vital. And for you to realize, you can take your ego out of it, but then it has nothing to do with whether or not, with that you not being desirable. That's really not part of the equation in the vast majority of cases. And think of it, this is the way the analogy that Jeff used that I thought was really helpful for guys, is he said, you know, if you and your wife try to run a mile, or you go to the gym together, or you're doing something out back and you're cutting down trees and you're lifting logs, would you expect her to lift the same weight as you? Guys, would you? No, she's physiologically different, right? So this is something that Jeff finally realized. He's like, so why do we expect her to be physiologically the same in the bedroom? She's just physically different. And so apply that mental framework to this, that she needs to be approached differently than you would, and you'll be a lot happier. I mean, for you, for most men, you're tired. The thought of sex cancels exhaustion, right? I mean, this is a fix to exhaustion. And realize that's just not the way she is at all. Now, and also, women, let me flip it back for you to understand something about him here. there is something here about the emotional context of this and the importance of feeling desired that for you, it may explain something that may have been confusing to you. Because a lot of women say that sometimes when they're feeling least like that is when he most is approaching them. Because you're at odds, you're not close, you're feeling that, and so he's approaching you for this. And realize, ladies, there is something that is very important for you to understand about men here emotionally, which is that for them, it's not just emotional, it is a biological component to this, that one of the times they feel closest to their wife is in this time. And literally, women, just so you know, you probably heard this, there's a hormone that our bodies release called oxytocin. You might have heard this. It's called the bonding hormone or the cuddle hormone. Because it's what moms release, it's what happens in our body when we're nursing a baby, for example. Oxytocin is released. There's other times in a woman when oxytocin is released. You're nursing a baby, you're having a real deep conversation with a friend, and you feel very close to them. There's all these different times in a woman's life that oxytocin is released, and it builds this bonding, this feeling of closeness. Well, ladies, there is only one time in a man's life when oxytocin is released. Just take a wild guess when that is. And that is, when you see your husband approaching you in this way, and you're thinking, how dare he? We're so at odds, or whatever. Realize this is a man's way of instinctively trying to get closer to someone he desperately wants to feel closer to. He's trying to bridge a gap. So realize that there is a big piece of that puzzle going on. And realize that when he approaches you in this way is when a man is most vulnerable. Because it is so much him putting himself out there. Be thinking about that. Let the Lord speak to you on this. Be willing to pray about it and ask, you know, if this has been an issue. Be willing to really pray it. And I would suggest even journal, you know, different things about the way that you see different things working in your relationship. Now, I will also tell you, ladies, that as I was talking to the men about this subject and what is that sort of pinnacle of sort of emotional depth that they felt, and what is it that really makes them feel the most desired and has that emotional impact that we want to be able to have on them. I kept hearing guys reference this song from the 70s. You know the song Behind Closed Doors? You guys remember this song where the lines, I don't even remember it, but apparently one of the main lines in the song is, you know, I want the girl next door in the living room and the wild cat in the bedroom. And, you know, the guys kept bringing that up, and I'm like, good luck, buddy, you know, with the wildcat in the bedroom. And finally, I'm like, okay. And we were talking with a guy who's a really good friend of mine, and Jeff's, and Jeff was sitting there with me. So I started asking these guys in sort of a more safe environment when Jeff was with me, or we were with other couples, and I'd say, what does that mean? What's a wildcat? You know, what's that mean to you? And the guys all said the same thing. It just means she makes the first move once in a while. That's a wildcat, ladies. That is actually really good news. Most women. You can do that. The first move, you can do that once in a while. Okay. So let me switch it. And let's talk briefly about the singles application for this, because this was a powerful emotional finding for me. For those of us who have teenagers, singles in the room, or you know, have friends, people mentoring, whatever, when after seeing the emotional ramifications, the emotional involvement, so when I was researching for men only and for women only, I started to think, you know, if there's this emotional impact when this is happening inside marriage, which as a Christian, you know, biblically. You know, the Bible talks about it being designed for marriage. So if there's this emotional impact for physical intimacy in marriage where God says it's designed for, I wonder if there's an emotional impact if it's happening outside marriage. where God says it's not designed for. And boy, did we find it. When we asked the teenage boys, and we were doing the research for young women only, and we asked the teenage boys these questions, the guys, it was amazing, the guys have said, you know, they admitted they were probably the ones trying to talk their girlfriends into it, right? But two-thirds of the guys said as soon as she did, they started to doubt whether they could ever trust her again. Isn't that amazing? It's almost like the way the guys described it is that that feeling of being desired is so powerful that if that switch is flipped outside of a lifetime marriage commitment, he starts worrying that she's going to go give this powerful feeling to somebody else. And he doesn't want to, but it just happens. And it was interesting, I was doing some interviews, actually some on-camera interviews with some teenagers, and this one tough African-American football player kid from like an urban area, and he was like this big, you know, tough looking guy. And he sat down, we were talking about this, and he said, yeah, I've been there, I've gone that direction. And we were saying, what is it that causes you to start worrying that she's gonna go, you know, give this feeling to somebody else, you start not trusting her? He said, it's all about that insecurity, man. It's all about that secret thing that every guy has inside, that he's not good enough, he doesn't measure up. She's gone for some other guy. And I thought, wow, that's amazing that he admitted that, both things. And so that's one thing, that's the guy's side. And when we looked at the numbers for the girls, when we were doing the research for young men only, the numbers were even higher, where 82% of the girls said that they had hormones too. You know, they had those same physical desires, but as soon as they crossed that line, because they knew it was happening outside of a lifetime marriage commitment, they started worrying about losing him. They started feeling insecure and possessive and clingy and a little like, okay, we're gonna spend all of our time together now, right? And you know, these feelings that again, they didn't want necessarily, they just happened. And you know, usually this possessive, insecure, clingy girlfriend is usually not what the average teenage boy is going for. And so if both of these things, you can see how these emotional impacts undermine the relationship they're probably trying to build and didn't intend for it to happen that way, it just did. This is one reason, talking about these things, it's one of the reasons why I love doing, I do school assemblies pretty frequently. I was telling Pam about that earlier. And this is one reason I love doing these school assemblies, because all these kids have heard, I mean, you guys know what the education is like in the schools on this subject. It's all about don't have sex because you'll get an STD, right? I mean, that's pretty much the only thing they can bring up. And it's like, no, there's all this new research now that's talking about the emotional impact of that. Because which kid thinks that they're going to get an STD? You know, it's just, that's not part of their radar screen. So for those of you who know teenagers, and for those of you who know people or mentor people in the singles community, just realize this is powerful, because once you hear it, you know what, that's right, that's correct. And it's really helpful for us to be able to help our kids through this, as well as for singles to realize. Now, obviously, God has grace for those of us who've made that mistake, but it is so much better if we can avoid having those negative ramifications come up to begin with, right? Okay. We are at a point where I would like to stop for about 5 minutes and let everybody who hasn't turned in a question, turn in a question if you want to. And I will go grab the questions and look through them real quick and then come back and do the question and answer time. And are you okay, Jason, if, you know, if somebody just wants to ask a question, hands up, as well as written, are you okay with that?
Absolutely.
All right. So how about we just take a quick 5-minute break, give me your questions if you haven't already done that. And we'll do that.
And we did bring some snacks over, so there are some cookies back here.